you. Thank you so very, very much. Certainly a pleasure to have a great group of the cable service operators from entire northeast section and southeast section here with us today. And I think we have quite a program in store for you. One match that everybody is already talking about will take place later on in the program. And that's when the superstar goes up against Bruce Reed. And that should be a classic confrontation. We'll be talking about that a little bit more as we get into the program. First of all, let's bring up the situation about the most popular wrestler contest. If you'd like to enter this contest, you may do so by voting for your favorite wrestler. Please put the name of your favorite wrestler on a postcard, include your name and address, and send it to Georgia Championship Wrestling, and that'll be at 100 Techwood Drive Northwest, Atlanta, Georgia, 30303. That's 100 Techwood Drive Northwest, Atlanta, Georgia, 30303. And please bear in mind that is postcard only. Postcards only, otherwise your vote will not count. And I might point out we are receiving thousands and thousands of cards, so get yours in the mail as quickly as possible. The winner will receive this trophy. Now then, in addition to all of this, I might just point out that next week here on Georgia Championship Wrestling, we are hopeful of having the eighth wonder of the world. I'm referring, of course, to Andre the Giant. That's right, Andre the Giant from Grenoble, France. He's 7 feet 4 inches tall, weighs in around about 450 pounds. His weight will vary, of course, as to his diet and training regimen, but he is truly a giant of a man, a gentle giant, I might point out, outside the ring, but inside the ring, an exceptionally dangerous individual. There you can see Andre the Giant, and he's standing next to a fellow who's right at 6 feet tall. You can see the tremendous size of this man, the eighth wonder of the world, Andre the Giant. Hopefully we'll have him here on the program next week. I want to take a moment right now to welcome to Georgia Championship Wrestling a man who has been gone for some time. Since his return, he made the prognosis that he was going to achieve a title in a very, very short period of time. He's done that indeed. He is now the National Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, the superstar. Welcome back.
There's a lot of individuals that come out on television and say what they're going to do, and it's a lot of hot air. You know that as well as I do. It's very unusual in this day and age for an individual to stand up in front of an audience or stand up in front of a group of people and make a statement and go out and intentionally go out and win that championship like I said I was going to do.
Well, there's certainly no question about it. You have done it, and you've done it in record time, in my opinion. Of course, I would imagine, too, now there are a list of top men who would be after your title. I'm referring to men like wrestling, too.
I knew someone sooner or later would come up and ask me about my intentions. And I happen to make out my own list. If you'd hold that championship belt, don't run away with it.
All right.
I've got a list of top contenders.
Top contenders.
Individuals that I feel have or should have a golden opportunity to come after my championship belt. Bunk Harris. Haystacks Calhoun. Snake Brown, a very tough competitor. Rick Link. Mike Fever. There's a lot of individuals. Even Danny Miller might go on that list. So I see there's a lot of individuals, a lot of people say, are you going to put your championship belt up? I'll put my championship belt up against anybody who I feel is very, very competent.
And these, you feel, are the most competent right now? This is your primary list?
Are you questioning my ability? Are you questioning my mental ability as well as my wrestling ability? These men right here are top competitors. If they win a championship match, I'll gladly sign.
Well, isn't that interesting? And I'm thinking of men like Wrestling 2, Tommy Wildfire Rich, Kevin Von Erich, Mike Sharp, and a host of others. And he's thinking of, well, okay. I might just point out once again, we are going to see this man in perhaps one of the toughest tests of his entire career later on in this program as Bruce Reed takes on the superstar here on Georgia Championship Wrestling. This and a host of other great matches coming up, including the sensational combination of Mike Sharp and John Studd in just a couple of moments. So we'll have those matches, and right now here's our ring announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, this event, one fall with a 10-minute time limit from Anderson, South Carolina. At 220 pounds, here's Jerry Mahoney. Jerry Mahoney. His partner from Florida, 208 pounds, meet Mike Fever. Mike Fever. Their opponents from Los Angeles, California, at 331 pounds, Big John Studd. John Studd. His partner from Canada, at 281 pounds, meet Iron Mike Sharp. Your referee is George Scott Jr. We'll be back with our first match after this brief timeout.
the bell. Referee George Scott Jr., John Studd, and Iron Mike Sharp. Studd in the pale blue wrestling tights and trunks.
Are you a redneck?
And it's Mahoney and the Fever. One fall, 10-minute time limit in this event. An Australian tag team. That's where you see Fever in the far corner. Mahoney tangles up very quickly with John Studd. Look at the size of this man, Studd, though. And even he would look, comparatively speaking, would look smaller next to Andre the Giant. But here you see this man, Studd, has just tremendous physical prowess. Studd caught Mahoney, a good shoulder smash, dropped him back to the canvas, brings him back to his feet. Brings him up, runs him into the knee of Iron Mike Sharp, and Sharp, out of Canada, makes the tag. Sharp, some 280 pounds, big, rugged, powerful individual. He and Studd, an awesome guy, and Mahoney fires to the midsection. It's Sharp retaliating. Again, Mahoney to the midsection, and again, Sharp with a forearm across the back, catching him right across the shoulder blades. And again, Mahoney caught in the pit of the stomach, and Fever makes the tag. Mike Fever moves out. Fever giving away some weight, has good speed, good agility. Collar and elbow back against the ring ropes. And it's Sharp missing with a wild right hand. George Jr. warned him briefly about closing up that fist.
Break him in half, Mike.
Full Nelson by Iron Mike Sharp. And Mr. Fever is going to have his problems now. I'm going to figure he either makes it. Well, he does. He makes it to the ring ropes. Tag is made. Big John Studd. Forearm across the back of Fever before he even steps over the top ropes. Wow. Right over the top ropes into the ring. Full body slam. The elbow across the back of Mike Fever. Fever driven back into that turnbuckle by Big John Studd. Studd now used that right hand as a club. Fever, with a forearm to the midsection, had little or no effect on Studd. Studd brings him up, has him in a variation of the bear hug. Notice he's only under the rib cage on one side, directly under it. Into the turnbuckle and then makes the tag with Mike Sharp. Sharp drives a knee into the back of Mike Fever. Mahoney, refreshed from being outside the ring, charges in on Iron Mike Sharp. Sharp turns around, forearm then a left to the midsection. Good reversal by Mahoney. Good reversal, but as he charged in, Sharp caught him with a forearm, and now Sharp using that forearm very effectively. Some double teaming here as they have Mahoney. Caught him just on the count of four, barely within the legal limitations. Big John Studd catches him in a bear hug. That one squarely across the back rib cage. Mahoney firing away, but has little or no effect on Studd. That one forced the break, however. Studd caught Fever, broke up the possibility of a tag combination there. Off the ropes, catches Mahoney, makes the tag. Iron Mike Sharp moves in once again. Remember, this match, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. And Mike Sharp now has Mahoney across those top ring ropes. And there you see again, double teaming on the part of Studd and Sharp. And Mahoney being beaten and beaten on that midsection. Fever tried to interfere. Sharp cast him aside. Mahoney back to the canvas once again. A hip toss that has Mahoney back to the canvas. Another high hip toss. Almost into a hype situation there. the Cornish hype, which is so very popular in England, Wales, and Ireland. And, of course, I'm sure that it carried over into Canada. And that, of course, is where Iron Mike Sharp is from. Fever makes the tag. Fever hooked by Big John Studd, and it is Sharp taking advantage of that situation. Has him up against the ring ropes. Fever in a lot of trouble, trying to get over to make the tag with Mahoney. And it is Fever making that tag with Mahoney. Mahoney moves back into the ring. They lock up, collar and elbow. Sharp pulls him back into the turnbuckle, a forearm, and then a left to the midsection. Brings him up a full body slam. Brings Mahoney back to his feet once again. Iron Mike Sharp now handling the man like a sack of vegetables. And now it is Big John Studd over that top rope. The other only other man I see do that with any regularity is Andre the Giant. Add him up into what could have been a pile driver. Now has him in a backbreaker. Both arms pinned across the front. And it is Mahoney very, very quickly conceding from that variation of a backbreaker. Extremely painful, those abdominal muscles being pulled, the back muscles being pulled, particularly down in that lumbar region. And so your victors, the tag team combination of Iron Mike Sharp and Big John Studd. First of all, let me remind you that next week we'll be back on at our regularly scheduled time, 5:35 Eastern Standard. Or Eastern Daylight, I take that back. 5:35 Eastern Daylight Time. We will be back on the air next week. And don't forget, too, to send in your postcards for your favorite wrestler contest. You may send those postcards to 100 Techwood Drive Northwest, Atlanta, Georgia, 30303. Postcards only, please, and list only your very, very favorite wrestler. Want to take a moment to talk? There's the bell. Wrestling 2 moving out against Ed Timms. One fall, a 10-minute time limit. Wrestling 2 in the white and black trunks and mask. Timms in the solid black outfit. Timms, of course, holding a weight advantage here and a height advantage. Bottom wrist lock into a lateral drop by Wrestling 2. Keeps the bottom wrist lock. Keeps that arm in prison. Many times you'll see them go from that bottom wrist lock to a lateral drop to a head scissors. Wrestling 2 did not. A variation, if you will, keeping that wrist lock and, of course, keeping that arm immobile. Now, Tim's trying to turn into his man, trying to turn it to his own advantage. And Wrestling 2 brings him back on over. And so Tim's has a problem there, and it's beginning to affect his shoulder as well. Good clean break by Wrestling 2. Back up against the ropes once again. And it's Timms with one to the midsection. Wrestling 2 fired back. A short, jolting forearm to the side of the head. Timms backing away, moves around, moves back in. Collar and elbow, side headlock by Wrestling 2. Wrestling 2, hip lock takedown on Timms. Referee George Jr. checking those shoulders. Timms in a predicament here, but only one shoulder down. At both shoulders down momentarily. Timms trying to press advantage here. They got into the ropes. The referee called for the break. Notice these smooth, fluid motions of 2. Back on his feet very quickly, very swiftly. Back to the ropes once again. Timms to the midsection. Timms again to the midsection. Wrestling 2, tiring of those tactics, uses a right hand of his own. Arm whips Timms off the ropes. Caught him. One. Just under the rib cage, coming off the ropes. Now a front chancery by Wrestling 2 with a wide, wide stance. Lots of leverage here, forcing Timms down to one knee. Forces him down to both knees and may try for an inverted press here, but I doubt it. Too early in the match for a hold of that kind, I think. Wrestling 2 keeping the front chancery. Timms back to his feet. Timms brings him back to the ropes. The referee again calls for the break. Wrestling 2 is set and ready in case Timms tried to move on him. Timms thought better of it, backed away. into a top wrist lock, back leg trip by Wrestling 2. So again, Tim is on his back on the canvas. The referee again checking those shoulders. The Wrestling 2 obviously testing his opponent, testing him for weight, for balance, for leverage, and for wrestling capability. And has dominated the match thus far, has maintained control over his opponent. Timms has not been able to move too effectively in an aggressive manner against Wrestling 2. Because Wrestling 2 combines that beautiful situation of being aggressive and defensive. He can switch so very, very quickly from a total offense to an all-out defense. Makes it difficult for an opponent to move on him with any real degree of certainty. Surprise is about the only element that can catch Wrestling. And that's one caught him. That's what I'm talking about. Tim suddenly exploded one to the midsection and Wrestling 2. A momentary lack of concentration, and that's all that it took. Tim sensed it and now has him caught again. Wrestling 2 back into that corner. That's as I would have put now a forearm across the back on Wrestling 2, and Wrestling 2 scores with the right hand to the side of the jaw. Tim's shaking his head. Wrestling 2 catches him coming off the ropes in the pit of the stomach again. Tim's is down. Wrestling 2 double to the back, and now Wrestling 2 catches him. A hooking right hand. Timms tried to slip away from it and in the process ended up on the canvas as he tried to slip by Wrestling 2. A backdrop came off the side of Wrestling 2's back. Full body slam by Wrestling 2. Wrestling 2 sets for that $1 million knee lift and caught him with it. Pinfall by Wrestling 2 over Ed Timms, and certainly a fine victory for Wrestling 2, who has just recently returned here to the state of Georgia and has proven himself once again to be the same kind of competitor that you always expect out of this man. Total and complete dedication to the sport that he's involved in, and when he sets for that high, high knee lift, generally, that is all she wrote, and it was indeed for Mr. Timms at that particular point in time. Well, I'm hoping there you hear it. Yes, indeed. The music of the fabulous Freebird. And that, of course, means the entrance of one Michael Hayes. And there you see him in front of the camera, a gentleman who is certainly not short on modesty whatsoever.
Song sounds so good, Gordon Soley. You know, Gordon, that's a funky name. I gotta tell you that, baby. That's a funky name, Gordon. You know, last night I just happened to get just a little bit of time home with the old lady. And she got to looking real close at this face because we had the lights down low. It was romantic. Woo! And she said, you know, I noticed you got another scar on top of your head, Michael, but I still think you look sexy. And I said, well, thank you, baby, but you see, you understand that the looks and all that stuff is in my past because now I got to get even, like I've been talking about, like my big new friend. Y'all know who I'm talking about, baby. Can y'all sort of spy him up so everybody knows? Now, I know you're going to say right now, in the Omni.
Right.
But don't worry about the Omni because tonight the Freebird and all of Fantasia are going to go to Sweet Home Gadsden, Alabama. That's right, because there's still a week to go, Terry. And you see, I done decided what I'm going to do, boy, is I'm going to take it nice and slow. And I'm going to pick your mind apart piece by piece, what little bit I ain't beat out already. And I'm going to hurt you slowly, because you're never going to know where I'm coming from or what I'm going to do. And Mr. Superfly has got the honorable and dubious distinction of trying to handle 7 feet of only the good Lord knows what to do with.
Andre the Giant.
That's
indeed.
Right, Andre the Giant. Now, you said he may be a gentleman outside of the ring, But me and Andre gonna get down and dirty because we gonna feel kind of mean, and baby, we gonna take it from one to the other extreme. Because I got something to do. And y'all know, when Fantasia got something to do, it's got to get done.
The bell has rung. Kevin Von Erich in the white trunks moving out against Rick Ferrara in the blue trunks. This match, one fall, a 10-minute time limit. Here you have an interesting combination. Kevin Von Erich. Extremely well-muscled and absolutely no wasted flesh on his body at all. This, of course, can serve as a partial detriment when it comes to bruises. Look at the move on Kevin Von Erich. Beautiful move into a head scissors from a disadvantaged position. He's a young man, a very, very cool, quiet, confident young man. And for his young career, I think one of the outstanding achievements on his part was winning the Missouri Heavyweight Championship. And that title, of course, having been held by some great former world heavyweight champions, including Dorian Terry Funk, also Jack Briscoe. So he's in some very, very heady company, and a beautiful arm drag takedown. Because of the toughness, as I say, there's no wasted flesh on Kevin. He will cut and bruise perhaps a little easier than some competitors. And if you'll check his elbows very carefully and also his leg, you can see an example of what I'm talking about. And this, of course, is the one area in which he has to be so very, very careful. But he has got just a tremendous amount of talent and ability in the ring. Facing a man right now, Rick Ferrara, compactly built, very solid, extremely dangerous, and has the edge and experience. Kevin Von Erich now gets the arm drag and twist, good step over. Hooks, upper thigh and a forward roll takedown by Kevin Von Erich. Much to the pleasure of the group here at the Television Sports Arena here at Super 17. And a real pleasure to have slam by Ferrara. Von Erich tenaciously hung onto that hold and scored the takedown. And it is Kevin Von Erich keeping the inside armbar now on Rick Ferrara, wrestling two, who just had a successful match just a couple of moments ago with Ed Timms, has joined me.
Thank you. It's a pleasure being here again, Gordon.
And we're watching watching Kevin Von Erich. Ferrara, as I said earlier, of course, holds a definite edge and advantage. Good sequence there by Kevin Von Erich. He blocked it very nicely. What could have been a hip toss takedown by Ferrara would now turn into the takedown by Kevin Von Erich.
Very true. Man's a very outstanding wrestler.
Certainly no question about that. The comments, of course, we're hearing now from Mr. Wrestling number two, and it's Ferrara overhooking the head as Kevin Von Erich also overhooking the head. They're back into those ring ropes. Referee George Jr. calls for the break. Good clean break.
A lot of very classic moves, which will be very interesting. One day, perhaps he and I will face one another in the ring. Give me the opportunity to see how really good he is. I know he comes from a long background of wrestlers, and you know, normally when the boys come up in that stage, they're generally pretty good.
Well, he is indeed, I think, an outstanding competitor. He's got two brothers who also compete. Ferrara now may have... It appears that he may have a broken nose. He caught an elbow as he went up into those ring ropes. He caught an elbow in the nose, and he appears to possibly have some problems there. That is going to cut down on his breathing, obviously. It could cause Ferrara some problems.
That's the unfortunate things of our profession, but they happen all the time, and you have to accept them or learn to accept them. You know, getting away from this right at the moment, I'd like to thank all the fans, all the wonderful, beautiful fans that I have out there, for all the lovely cards that they've been sending in for me, for that beautiful trophy that is at stake. I have no, as I said before, no whims about who's going to win, because it's all running my way so far. I just hope some of the other fellows get some cards also. Gordon, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure standing out here talking with you.
Okay. Thank you, Wrestling 2, who, of course, is referring to the most popular wrestler contest and apparently very confident that he is going to win. Pereira whipped into that far turnbuckle, and Kevin Von Erich drives that knee to the side of the rib cage once again. And Ferreira's shaking his head again. So he has suffered some severe percussions to the head. And is quite possibly beginning to take its toll on him. High in that time. Beautiful head scissors applied by Kevin Von Erich. Kevin Von Erich into a full body slam. Kevin Von Erich closes in on him once again. There's into that Von Erich lateral roll. Kevin Von Erich lateral roll catches him with a lateral body scissors into a roll and into a pinning combination. And Von Erich started to offer his hand. Ferreira shook it off, and so it is a referee checking Ferreira now. He has got, I'm pretty sure in my book, he's got a broken nose. But nonetheless, a fine victory for Kevin Von Erich. Another moment right now to talk to the National Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, the superstar. I've had a lot of letters. A lot of people have called me on the phone requesting further information about the superstar. It's quite obvious once you get in the ring that you are a highly trained professional athlete. A lot of people, and I don't want you to, you obviously want to keep your identity a secret. That's certainly your prerogative. But I just wonder if you'd be kind enough to perhaps give us some sort of an amateur background. What sports did you participate in?
You know, Gordon, I respected you for a long time for the simple fact that you were one of the few individuals who never pried into my background. Now, don't let me stand out here and lose some respect for you. The fact remains that I am a professional wrestler. I choose to wear a mask because I enjoy my privacy. I also like to get into the ring and meet these individuals in the ring. Now, don't ask me about my past, because I don't live in the past. I live for present day and future. Nothing more.
Fair enough. Let's talk about the future, then. And let's talk about Saturday night at the Omni in Atlanta, the 29th. Tickets are on sale at All Seats locations and the Omni, of course. And you will be going after Tommy Wildfire Rich in the Georgia title.
First of all, I'm going to have a tune-up match tonight in Carrollton. Then I'm going to get down to business next week in the Omni. Tommy Rich, you only have one more week. It seems as everybody's upset with me right now. Steve O's mad because he used to have this belt, and now I do. Wrestling 2, he's mad at everybody. And Tommy Rich is upset because he's got 13 stitches in his head. Well, Tommy, I'm a little mad, too, because I meant to give you 38. You've got one more week, 7 more days to think about it. I'm ready. I already have a championship belt. But Saturday night in the Omni, I'm coming after the Georgia Heavyweight Championship. There's not going to be any excuses, Tommy. I've only got one match to prepare for, not two. Just one man to think about. And I'm thinking about you 7 more evenings.
We have an Australian tag team matchup now. The Georgia tag team champions, Jimmy Superfly Snuka and Terry Gordy, moving up against the combination of Rick Thor and Jimmy Powell. One fall, and there's Gordy with, and he is good at that. He will deliberately taunt an opponent, an open-handed slap across the face, anything to get his opponent angry, to make a mistake. Gordy, with that massive size, that tremendous physique, is a devastating opponent. And he and Snuka, what a combination. Thus far, nobody has been successful in trying to turn back this awesome combination of Snuka and Terry Gordy. Terry Gordy with a good high knee lift that time. Thor in trouble, hanging onto those ropes now. And it's Terry Gordy, a snapmare, makes the tag with the Superfly. Snuka out there, Snuka from the Fiji Islands. And you talk about perfect physical development. He has it. Notice the trapezius muscles, the trapezius dorsi, the pinnae erecti. muscles. The man is, no matter where you look at him, he's in superior condition. Tag is made. Terry Gordy moves out once again. Oh, hurtled through those ropes, and Gordy right outside the ring right after him. Gordy hurdles him back into the ring. And so far, Powell has not had an opportunity to tag up. And it is Thor hurtled outside the ring once again. Snooker taking advantage of that situation. And it is Thor outside those ring ropes. And again, Snooker double teaming. And this is the thing about the team of Snooker and Gordy. They will press every advantage possible, because normally they would have superior size in the ring. They're not the least bit afraid to take total advantage of that situation. And that's exactly what they're doing right now. Snooker moves in, makes the tag. Snooker, hard right hand to the side of the jaw. Another one catches him off the shoulder. The tag is made. Powell moves in. Again, the tag was made. Terry Gordy moves in. Cheap shot to the midsection before the break, and Powell firing back, but now Gordy catches him once again. Snapmare that has the foul down. Sneaking through the legs, making the tag. Thor moves into the ring once again. Terry Gordy has him back into that far turnbuckle. Gordy and Snooker, of course, there they have a ring up. High, high vertical souffle. They are the Georgia tag team champions. And as devastating a combination as I've ever seen in action. Once again, the tag is made. Jimmy Superfly Snooker balancing up on that top ring rope. Crashes down across him. Full weight of that body coming down across the chest of Thor. Now goes into that claw hold across the jaw. It's technically a mandible claw. And the referee very quickly calling for the bell. The referee very quickly calling for the bell. And Snooker, of course, when he comes off that top rope with his full body down across the chest of an opponent, that generally knocks the wind out of them, stuns them to the point that Snooker is able to move in with that claw hold across the jaw. And Thor coming up very, very slowly. We may get a chance to see that again. There you see Snooker moving up on the top ring rope, balancing his body on that top ring rope. And now the full weight down across the chest, catching him squarely in the rib cage, and of course knocking the wind out of them and scoring the pinfall. Actually, it is a submission and pinfall combination. Very devastating indeed.
Hey, that's right, Gordon Soley. Anything we do is devastating, baby. You know, it's just like this, baby. We are the champions. I want this camera right here. I want you to get a good close-up. I want you to take a good look at
them. Well, we have a good look at them. They're the Georgia Tag Team Champions, and we'll be back in just a moment. Well, continuing now our conversation with the Georgia Tag Team Champions. We had to break away there for a quick commercial message, but nonetheless, quite an impressive victory.
Hey, that's right, Gordon Soley. Just before I got rudely interrupted and just before the station took a commercial break, I was telling the cameraman, would you get a close-up shot right here on both of us? Could you do that on both of us right here? Could you get a close-up shot so the people can see their champions, baby? Because you got something to look at, you know. We're young, we're pretty, and we're mean, baby.
Well, maybe after next Saturday night when you and Mr. Snooker face Michael Hayes and Andre the Giant, things might be a little different.
Hey, you know, Michael Hayes might not even make it till next Saturday night, because tonight in Gaston, Alabama, we're going to be getting down on your head, boy, just like it's supposed to be done. And now, next Saturday night in the Albany, baby, that's where it's all going to take place. If you at Michael Hayes. You know, I'm going to let my brother, Superfly, right here, take care of the big freak. That's what I said, a big freak. Well, I take care of this Michael Hayes. You know, Michael Hayes, like I told you before, boy, you did the wrong thing, man. When you come messing with fire, you're going to get burnt, boy.
There are going to be a lot of surprises in store for a lot of people. Next Saturday night at the Omni, tickets on sale at all seats, locations, and the Omni.
Attention wrestling fans, on Saturday, August 29th, 8:30, the Omni in Atlanta, such stars as Kevin Von Erich, Wrestling Number 2, Steve O, George Wells, plus these matches, 400-pound Chris Cannon against 300-pound Bruiser Brody, Georgia Heavyweight Championship, Tommy Wildfire Rich, champion against the Masked Superstar, and Andre the Giant. 7'4", 500-pound, eighth wonder of the world, teams with fabulous Freebird Michael Hayes against Snuka and Gordy. That's the 29th, the Omni.
Ladies and gentlemen, this event, one fall, with television time remaining from Kansas City at 245 pounds. Here's Bruce Reed. Bruce Reed, his opponent, at 270 pounds, the new national heavyweight wrestling champion. Here is the Superstar, the Superstar.
And what a classic match this should prove to be. Bruce Reed, who I feel will be giving away the edge in experience, but he is not giving away anything else whatsoever. Bruce Reed, a finely tuned, finely honed athlete, going up against the Superstar. I know, in watching the Superstar, I was a little surprised at his shortness with me. And I have to lay that perhaps to just a little bit of nervousness on his part. The fact that and there you see Bruce Reed outpowering the Superstar. And the Superstar, I'm sure if you could read his face at this time, has to be looking with somewhat disbelief at this man, Bruce Reed. Bruce Reed, out of Missouri, the Show Me State, and boy, he proves that point every time he steps into the ring. You gotta show him. A series of forearms by the Superstar. And Bruce Reed retaliates. Reed catches him again and again and again. Bruce Reed has the Superstar to the canvas, and the Superstar leaves the ring. And so, perhaps the Superstar is beginning to believe it's time to regroup. Count is on. Bruce Reed waiting for him, pacing back and forth in the ring. And the Superstar, unnerved, I am sure. Bruce Reed sets, ready. Good head scissors by Bruce Reed from the hip lock takedown by the Superstar. And again, both men back on their feet. And so, the Superstar is beginning to find out something about Bruce Reed that he may not have noticed before. Reed is an outstanding counter wrestler. And that is the key to this match, in my opinion. Reed is the counter wrestler. Now watch the Superstar carefully. Caught him on the break that time. A cheap shot by the Superstar. And Reed, countering that time, counters again. Has a Superstar in trouble. Reed again with a good forearm. Cross body block by Bruce Reed. And it has the Superstar again outside the ring. And Steve O, of course, who lost that national heavyweight championship to the Superstar, watching this match with more than an obvious great deal of interest.
Well, Gordon, you know, the Superstar came up with a super effort to beat me. He beat me for the title in Columbus, Georgia, and I'll have to give him a little bit of credit for that. He's a tremendous condition athlete. He knows a lot about wrestling, and right now you can just show how smart he thinks he is by getting out of the ring when the action gets tough. It's a tactic that I think he's used to his advantage for a long time. Now, Gordon, I haven't come out here to yell and scream about anything. In the championship contract, there was no return clause. Now, I want to come out and issue a challenge to Superstar or to perhaps whoever will be the national champion. I think I deserve a return match at the championship, whether it's on television or whether it's in Columbus, Georgia, or wherever it might be.
Well, certainly, I think you're entitled to that also. Once again, their collar and elbow, and it's Reed now with a side headlock. And noting the superstar in your comments about the tactics he uses of getting outside the ring, it, I think, is much like a football team who's down 7 points, and all of a sudden the opponent's offense is rolling. They want to stop that momentum. They'll call a timeout. This is exactly what I think he attempts to do when he gets out of the ring.
Well, I think he's just trying to stop his opponent's momentum. Right now, Bruce Reed in control. Superstar's got to be thinking of an escape. Whenever Bruce seems to have things rolling his way, Superstar's going to take a powder, so to speak, let things cool down so he can plan out his strategy. And I think he's very smart in this respect, but I can't respect him at all for getting out of the ring in the heat of the battle. You're supposed to stay in there and do combat where combat's supposed to be done.
A precise point by Steve O. I would imagine right now the superstar has to be thanking his lucky stars that his title, National Heavyweight Championship, is not on the line because Bruce Reed catches him again. And the superstar, and again, there he goes. Outside the ring, he's hurt. He is hurt, no question about that. Instinct and that intellect took him outside the ring. It breaks the momentum of Bruce Reed. It breaks the count. And it gives him an extra 10 seconds or so, perhaps even more, to recoup himself, to get his breath back, and also to get that head moving right.
You know, Bruce Reed has become famous for that shoulder block. He learned that, I'm sure, in his old football days. Superstar's got to be thinking right now that he's going to have to take some shortcuts, because I don't think he can last much longer blow for blow with Bruce Reed. Right now, he's got to be thinking of what he can do to get this match over as quickly as possible.
And you can hear the crowd here now picking up that momentum, and they're obviously solidly with Bruce Reed, and once again, the superstar utilizing the ring rope stops that momentum, and psychologically, it even stopped it on the crowd, and that's exactly what he's out to do.
Well, you know what's going to happen right now? It's going to make Bruce Reed frustrated. It's going to make him possibly make a mistake in there, and that's what Superstar is looking forward to. Bruce Reed could become over-aggressive. He knew he had him hurt for that time. He's going back to work on that shoulder. He knows he had him hurt. He's going to work on it and possibly weaken his man to the point where he can gain a pin for him.
And as we have said so many, many times, wrestling is not only a test of weight, of strength, of balance, of wrestling knowledge, but psychological aspects of it as well. It is indeed human chess at its very finest.
Well, you know, the psychological aspects go to the point where countering moves. In the ring, you might be able to taunt your man with saying things to him. You might be able to lull him into sleep with certain moves and the way you act, and then all of a sudden explode, trying to hide what's really happening to your body or what's really happening to you. I can see right now that the superstar isn't hiding a thing. He's obviously in pain. Bruce Reed has got to move for a quick pinfall here, weaken his man. We're at his weakest point, and right now it's his arm and his shoulder. If he can underhook that other arm, get him over for a pinning combination, he might be all right.
It might be indeed, and Bruce Reed continues to use that knee effectively into the biceps and triceps of the superstar. And so the superstar, who uses that cobra hold with such deadly efficiency, may be frustrated in that attempt today. He may not be able, if he attempts to get that hold, to apply full pressure. So Bruce Reed, certainly, I think, is using a good series of stratagems here. Snap mare, but Reed back on him, hanging on like a bulldog now.
As you can see, Gordon, Bruce has got those tremendous arms. He's got the tremendous neck muscles. He can hang on without being tired out. What will happen so often in a wrestling match is an opponent will get a hold on, and the opponent that has the hold put on him will wait for that moment when the man on top will get tired so he can recognize that and work his escape. Right now, he just might be waiting for Bruce Reed to tire before he picks out his moment, picks out his time.
One bit of relaxation, one bit of slackness in that. All right, into the bottomless leg, and the superstar slips away from it, drives that knee in Bruce Reed off the ropes. Good reversal by Reed once again. Outstanding move, and this once again we get back to the counter wrestling. And that's exactly what Bruce Reed has been doing thus far. counter wrestling when the need is called for it and becoming totally offensive in between those periods of time. And so the superstar has suddenly found himself, for probably one of the rare times in his career, at a very, very disadvantaged position.
Well, especially on national television, too, because Bruce Reed is coming up with a super effort here. He's got him, he's got his arm trapped there. He's obviously got him in pain. He's got him in trouble. Superstar, the new national champion. Looks like his title might be short range.
Could be indeed, and of course, Bruce Reed, in scoring a victory here, would do much to destroy the confidence of the superstar and would make it, in fact, much easier for the next man to face the superstar to possibly score that pinfall or submission hold and take that national heavyweight championship away from him. Up against those ring ropes once again now. And here's where the superstar is so exceptionally dangerous. Caught him that time, glanced off his forehead, and stunned Bruce Reed. Reed powers out before the count of three, however, and he goes into that rear chin lock. And Reed now having his problems. So the superstar proving, however, Steve, that he's got great resiliency.
Well, never taking that away from him. With great resiliency, great size, great speed, great strength, and also we've been talking about his intellect. And right now, he's in a fight for his life, and right now, instinct takes over.
Whipped him back, caught him with a beautiful flying dropkick. It's Bruce Reed in with a lateral press. The superstar powers out, only a count of one. The superstar charges again, catches him a good shoulder smash. Bruce Reed up the... Dive for him, and...
set him up for that one. He set him up, and then he missed.
And there again, the psychological and intellectual warfare that goes on. Reed stunned from being caught on those ropes.
Superstar picking his time there.
And is going for the Cobra. He is going for the Cobra. Bruce Reed stunned after catching those ropes, and Reed trying to battle his way out, and it is... And the superstar is having trouble putting that Cobra on.
He's going for the mask.
Reed trying for that mask. Our time is rapidly expiring here. The Cobra hold, and it is the superstar closing in with that Cobra hold. Continues to close in. And it looks like the superstar is taking the measure here. The outstanding matches that I've ever seen here on Georgia Championship Wrestling, that match between Bruce Reed and the superstar. And I might point out, of course, as we were pointing out during the match itself, Bruce Reed is an excellent counter wrestler. And the competition here in Georgia right now is so keen and so sharp that on any given day, I think a title could change hands. Let's go back and take a look at the closing moments of this match. It was when the superstar, and you'll notice now Bruce Reed coming off, made the leap for the superstar. He ducked to one side. Reed caught those ring ropes, stunning himself, caught himself across the throat, and obviously knocked the wind out of himself. The superstar, very quickly seizing on this opportunity, whipped him off the ropes, caught him with those massive biceps coming off the ropes, right across the throat once again, another percussion blow, another point of taking away the ability to breathe, and now closes in with the Cobra hold. You'll note now, as I said earlier, he was having a little problem applying that Cobra hold. He finally got it applied totally and completely. And so Bruce Reed was defeated. Been one of the most closely fought contests I've seen in a long time. Well, the original Freebird now, Michael Hayes, has joined me. And I think you would have to admit, as well as anybody else, that was an outstanding match between the superstar and
Super
Bruce
match
Reed.
When you have top weight contenders on television against each other. And I thought Bruce did a fine job. But to get away from that, you know, the reason I'm out here is because I want to let everybody know that history's going to take place in just a little while, because me and Wildfire Tommy Rich going to team up and get right in there. I'm going to put on some trunks, and we're going to see just what we can do together.
This will be a first for television, I might point out. Michael Hayes and Tommy Wildfire Rich as a tag team combination. That's coming up.
Boy, nobody cares about you and Wildfire, man. What are you doing out here talking about you and Wildfire when nobody cares about it?
Well, now, just a minute, gentlemen. I don't want any problems here at the desk. I'm talking to Mr. Hayes.
You know something? You've always got somebody standing right in front of you doing something for you. If it wasn't me, then it's him.
Hey, wait just a second. I don't need nobody.
Hey, don't you put your hand on me.
I don't need nobody. That's just what I'm
saying. Hold it. Michael Hayes, a free-for-all erupting here. And,
TV like this. I don't like to be embarrassed, man. Look at that.
Well, I'm sorry, sir, but you came out here uninvited. I was talking to Mr. Hayes. I don't wish to take issue or sides in the situation at all. But I'd appreciate it, gentlemen, if you would just leave this area because we've got a program here, and I prefer to have nothing.
Thankfully, boy.
Yeah, that's something, man. That's really something. I come out here to say a few words. And I get a jacket ripped off of me. Well, that's not the point. You know, I'll go buy 100 of these jackets, boy. It's just a part of you trying to embarrass me right here on nationwide TV. And you're not going to do it, Michael Hayes.
Yeah, well, okay, I'll tell you what, gentlemen. I think we better move along with the program while we can. Let's turn it over to our ring announcer, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, this event, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing from Decatur at 241 pounds, here's Ken Timms. Ken Timms. His opponent, ladies and gentlemen, from Minneapolis, Minnesota, one of professional wrestling's great competitors, here's the Nature Boy himself, Ric Flair. Ric Flair. Your referee is Nick Patrick. We'll be back with this match right after this brief timeout.
The bell. Ric Flair moving out against Ken Timms. Flair certainly... The top contender. He is a double tough individual. Timms, brother of Ed Timms, vastly improved competitor, facing a tough test here in Ric Flair. Full arm drag and twist and takedown by Flair. Flair in the red trunks. Again, fantastically conditioned athlete. And it's Timms utilizing the ring ropes, forces the break. And Flair suddenly is... And Flair likes to carry on with the audience, carry on conversations with the audience, and he is the first one to admit to his own greatness when he's in that ring. And he will do it vocally. There's no question about that. Side headlock by Timms. Flair turns that into a top wrist lock. And it is Flair gaining the edge in leverage at that point. Down to an inside armbar. Up into the ring ropes once again. The referee calls for the break. Clean break by Flair. Backs away. Referee Nick Patrick. Once again. Timms unhooked with a hard right hand. Another one. On the break, and Flair caught on that one. Now gets Timms back in the corner, and Flair retaliating. And it is Flair. Putting some devastation on Timms, catches him. A side back drop, and now brings him up once again. Full body slam. Ric Flair with an elbow across the chest. Flair overhooks the head, front face lock. Timms into the ring ropes, forces the break. Flair a little bit reluctant to break that time as he now recognizes exactly what kind of a competitor he's facing. All right, Flair watching him carefully. They move in, collar and elbow once again. From side headlock to a total hammerlock. Let's see if he wings that arm. He does not, but he's got it locked in. There's no question about that. Timms back to the canvas. Flair again. Flair, of course, a gentleman who goes 110% no matter what he's involved in, be it a wrestling match, if he's out hunting, swimming, scuba diving, you name it. He takes on life with a great intensity. All right, back into the turnbuckle once again. Ken Timms rips across the face of Flair. And now jams Flair's head into that turnbuckle. Overhooks the head once again. In fact, he has a front chancery on him now. Timms pressing that advantage, and Flair could have some problems here. Now Flair trying to break free from it if he can. Separates the hold into a full-arm dragon twist. And a chop across the chest that you could hear throughout the entire television sports arena. Again, Flair takes him off his feet. Now smashes him into that far turnbuckle. Timms in trouble now. Flair uses the elbow very effectively. A looping right hand, another hard right hand. Once again, the elbow. Timms hurtled through those ring ropes and out onto the concrete floor. Timms coming up rather slowly now, featuring the lower, favoring rather, the lower area of his back. The forearm into the chest of Timms. Drops Timms to the apron once again. Timms coming up rather slowly. Flair uses that elbow effectively. Timms trying to get back into that ring, and Flair continues the attack. Flair brings him back in through the ring ropes. Forearm across the chest. Flair now arm whips him across, catches him with an elbow. And Flair again keeps that running commentary going against his opponent. Brings him way, way up. High, high vertical souffle, and Flair. There he goes into that. Moves very effectively into that figure four, but it's applied to the opposite side than the way that the figure four is normally applied. Exceptionally effective, as we just saw. So Ric Flair, using the figure four, defeats Ken Timms in the opening match of this hour of Georgia Championship Wrestling, and a fine victory indeed for Ric Flair. Want to take a moment, and I'm sure we're going to hear that music momentarily of the fabulous Freebird. Perhaps we're not, but nonetheless. Here comes Tommy Wildfire Rich, and of course he and Tommy and Mike Hayes will be tag team partners a little bit later on in the program.
You know, that's going to be wrestling history, Gordon. The first time Michael Hayes and myself were teaming up together. You know, it looks like Hayes has finally seen the light. I didn't know if he was going to stick to it or if it was a trick or what. But evidently, you know, Hayes has had a turn of heart, a change of heart, or whatever you want to call it. You know, a while ago, the superstar, you know, he beat Steve-O for the belt. He won the belt. But now then, I heard him out here earlier talking about all the contenders, Snake Brown, Timms. You know, he ain't naming wrestling number two. He ain't naming Tommy Rich. He ain't naming Steve-O again. What's the matter, superstar? You ain't got the guts to lay the title out on the line? I give him a shot at the Georgia belt. I got the guts to do it. Just like I said, superstar. Anytime, any place, anywhere you want it, it's yours. Because I'm going to sign the contract anytime. I've got the guts. I ain't going to try to just sit on the belt and hold it.
Well, I can certainly understand that. You've always been that kind of a competitor. Of course, next Saturday night at the Omni in Atlanta, a crucial night.
Yeah, payback night. Payback night. The last Omni, superstar, you laid my head open 13 stitches. That's right. That's right, but I'm still here, and I'm well, I'm kicking, I feel better than ever. The Omni superstar, you better be ready, because not only am I coming to defend that belt, I'm coming for a little payback. If I get a chance to rip that hood off, I'm going to rip it right off your head. I'd like to see what that face is all about. You either got something inside that mask, like I said last time, your head was a little hard, so you either got something in there, or you're an awful ugly person. So at the Omni, we're going to find out just what it is, because if I get the chance, superstar, I'm going to pull that mask off, and then I'm going to beat you.
Thank you so very much. Tommy Wildfire Rich going up against the superstar of the Georgia Tag Team Championship on the line next Saturday night at the Omni in Atlanta. Tickets currently
Saturday
on
night. Yes, sir.
Tickets on sale at all seats, locations, and the Omni.
Attention wrestling fans, on Saturday, August 29th, 8:30, the Omni in Atlanta, such stars as Kevin Von Erich, Wrestling Number 2, Steve O, George Wells, plus these matches, 400-pound Chris Cannon against 300-pound Bruiser Brody, Georgia Heavyweight Championship, Tommy Wildfire Rich, champion against the Masked Superstar, and Andre the Giant, 7'4", 500-pound, eighth wonder of the world, teams with fabulous Freebird Michael Hayes against Snuka and Gordy. That's the 29th, the Omni.
Golf, your Tom Watsons, and football, your Steve Bartkowskis, and baseball, your George Bretts. And in wrestling, well, when you talk about superstars, that becomes synonymous with the word Ric Flair, and it's certainly a pleasure to have Mr. Flair back with us.
Well, Gordon, I appreciate that. Georgia, the focal point, Georgia Championship Wrestling, worldwide, the greatest competition. We talk about Snuka, Gordy, Rich, Steve-O, Wrestling 2, the superstar, the list is endless. And as I said a couple weeks ago, when these gentlemen want to find out where they really, truly stand, where they really, truly rank in professional wrestling, then all they got to do is pick up a piece of paper similar to this. It's called a contract. They put their name on one side, and I put my name on the other side. It's an open offer. Think about it, boys, long and hard. You know, I like to think of myself as a semi-clean living man now, Gordon. And I try to get in that ring and with an open mind. I try to give everybody an opportunity to wrestle by the rules. But if you want to get nasty, then Ric Flair, as a lot of wrestling fans will tell you, wrote the book on how to break the rules. He wrote the book on how to talk to the ladies. He wrote the book on how to dress. He wrote the book on the big cars to drive. He's written a book on a lot of things. But the main thing he's concentrating on right now is writing a book on professional wrestling. Georgia Championship Wrestling, a lot of big stars, a lot of big names, a lot of great competition. And Gordon Soley, I'm going to hang real tight right here until I take the measure of every man wrestling in the Georgia Championship area, like it or not. Woo!
There you have it, the comments from Ric Flair. Let's go to the ring. We've got an outstanding match coming up. Bruno Sammartino Jr. and George Wells facing Professor Sonoda and Tomahawk Thompson. Should be an outstanding event. And it is Sonoda out there. Now, Sonoda has had vast training in the martial arts and the oriental form of martial arts, which makes him an extremely dangerous man. He's facing Bruno Sammartino Jr. out of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And obviously, because Sonoda is from Japan and has had that opportunity of that previous training, coupled with what he... look at Sammartino Jr. bringing him up. Pressed him above his head into a full body slam. And Sonoda, coming up very slowly, as that vertebrae took a shock to it. There's no question about it. Wells ripped across the eyes by Sonoda. Sonoda now. Boot to the midsection. Aha! Beautiful move by Wells. Beautiful block. Outstanding block. Spins him around, drops him to the canvas, and Sonoda felt the sting of a good old-fashioned American right cross. Hip toss by Wells. Wells up. Flying head scissors, and George Wells has Sonoda gasping for air and also trying to put his head together. Tomahawk Thompson out there. Side headlock. Bruno Sammartino Jr. makes the tag with George Wells. Martino catches him coming in. Thompson off those ropes. Once again, Bruno Sammartino Jr. has him up. Thompson tried to block him. Sammartino would have none of that. Extremely powerful individual. Sonoda broke it up. Back on their feet once again. Arm drag takedown by Sammartino Jr. Sammartino using those knees effectively on Thompson. Tag is made once again with George Wells. Wells, 5 years with the CFL. Thompson tried to make that tag with Sonoda. Contact was made, and Sonoda moves in. Sonoda, you have to watch. He'll use karate if the opportunity arises. He is a crafty individual. Missed that time as Wells. Ducked away in an open slap. And that slap across the face can certainly make Sonoda feel like he has lost face in front of this crowd. As I say, of course, we do have an outstanding crowd of folks here today at our television sports arena. Many of them are cable system operators here at the big convention. Certainly a pleasure to have them aboard. Sonoda caught Wells under the chin that time. Has Wells in trouble. Sonoda closes in again. Sonoda, forearm now into a snap there. Has Wells back to the canvas. Wells started to tag up, but he's in the wrong corner, that is for sure. Thompson catches Wells after making the tag with Sonoda. Now Wells caught him, and what a solid right hand that was. Snap mare. Wells makes the tag with Bruno Sammartino Jr. Beautiful drop kick by Sammartino. Lateral press. Thompson powers out. Sonoda started to come in to interfere, being warned by the referee, Nick Patrick. Now, Martino brings him up again. Belly to back suplex on Thompson. And Thompson got out of it. He was able to get those shoulders off, and so Sammartino Jr. softening him up some more, offering more punishment. And no matter where you are right now, may I just point out, whether you're in, as an example, Madeira Beach, Florida, or Minneapolis, Minnesota, San Francisco, California, Long Island and New York, no matter where you are, when you get a chance to get out and see these matches live, you think they're exciting here, see them live. You will not be disappointed, I can assure you of that.
Kick, Bruno, kick, kick.
Sammartino powers out. Sonoda trying for the pinfall. Sammartino caught him with a short chopping right hand. Another right hand that glanced off the side of the head of Sonoda. A boot that was partially blocked by Sonoda. Sonoda goes to the midsection. Catches Sammartino in the throat that time. Sammartino could have some problems here. Sonoda again pressing that advantage. And a chant being picked up by the crowd here. Let's go. Let's go, Bruno. Speaking of people here today, we also have quite a group of great guys from the West Indies. Montserrat, West Indies. Nice to have them here. George Wells back. Wow, look at that backdrop. He had him 12 feet in the air. Off the ropes once again. Caught him. Flying cross body block. Count of three. Count of three. Bruno Sammartino and George Wells. And what a tag team combination they have proven to be. Doubled up all the way down the line. And they are victorious over that combination of Professor Sonoda from Japan and Tommy Hawk Thompson. You hear it. You hear it. The original Freebird. That's right. The fabulous Freebird, Michael Hayes. And in a little while, we're going to see him in action along with Tommy Wildfire Rich. And as you can see,
I'm getting ready, baby. Look at the body. It is getting ready. Good. I do. You know, I want to digress just a second. I've been getting letters from all over the country, and everybody's been asking me about my little brother and how he did in the baseball and all that. He did just fine, and I thank you for asking. But I want to get to something a little bit more to the point. You know, I heard the big baby out here whining and crying, and he said, I can go get me 10 more jackets.
I think he actually said 100.
Did he say 100? Well, I figure they're going at about $15 a piece. So if you get the camera up real close here, you'll see that I got $160. Now, 15 times 10 is 150, so that should buy you 10 more. And I guess everybody's wondering what the extra $10 is for. It's to buy you a big rattle. Because that's just what he looked like out here, a big baby Huey whining and crying. Hey, that's right, big baby Huey Gordy out here whining and crying about his little $15 jacket. Let me tell you something, baby. Next time, I'm going to start ripping and tearing at your body. You understand? And there ain't nowheres, no store you can go that can fix that. Now, you talk about the Omni. And he said, is Michael Hayes going to make it? Well, there's a lot of places in between that we just may meet up. You understand? It could be tonight in Gainesville, tomorrow night in Gainesville, tonight in Gaston, Monday night Augusta. I don't care. I'm going to be at the Omni because the Omni is now Freebird Building. That's right. The Freebird Building. And me and the biggest man that I could have found. The biggest man that I could have found, Andre the Giant. And I got a little surprise for y'all, see? Everybody's wondering, where is Andre? Don't worry about Andre. I got Andre just where I want him. And I'm going to get him just right. Right and funky, right and nasty. Because that's the way I like to be, you understand? I said it before, the face is beautiful. It was until y'all started beating on it. The body is right, but the heart is nasty, Gordon. And Terry, I got your number, baby. I'm going to pick you apart piece by piece.
Okay, calling for the bell now, and it is Fred McKenzie moving out against the superstar. The superstar, of course, the national heavyweight champion. And boy, what a match he and Bruce Reed had. I hope you didn't miss that one. That was a classic, I'll tell you that. Bruce Reed, an outstanding counter wrestler, and it proved, I think, once again, we're talking about the sharpness and the keenness of competition. The superstar out against Fred McKenzie right now. It'd be interesting to see what effect that match with Bruce Reed had on the superstar. Well, had him down, brought him back to his feet once again. The superstar caught him hard, hard right hand. Superstar brings him full body slam, and McKenzie has his problems now. As the superstar venting, I am sure, some of the rage and anger that he must have felt. That is extremely frustrating match with Bruce Reed. But now, again, it brings this man up. There's not a lot of it. Ooh. And McKenzie in a lot of trouble outside. He hit that concrete. And the superstar brings him up again. Another full body slam that has to jar the spine and knock the air out. McKenzie coming up very, very slowly. The superstar uses a forearm across the back. And again, the superstar using that forearm. And McKenzie back into the ring, but he is now almost to a point of being helpless. The superstar just continues his punishment. And so I can't help but feel that this young man, Fred McKenzie, is paying the toll that the superstar was unable to extract from Bruce Reed. And it is now the superstar dealing with this man with a cold, cool, icy vengeance. A neckbreaker has McKenzie to the canvas. Lateral press did not allow the pin again. McKenzie was trying to bring his head up and bring that shoulder up, and the superstar brought it right. And McKenzie went to the midsection, had no effect whatsoever. Again, McKenzie fires to the midsection, a desperation punch. And it just didn't have the authority with it. And it is now again the superstar punishing this man, McKenzie. Arm whips him off the ropes. Caught him coming off the ropes, using. And now goes into the Cobra hold. Goes into the Cobra swiftly and surely. You'll note no hesitation here. Full application of the Cobra down across that carotid artery. And And McKenzie, obviously unable to continue, the referee calling for the bell. It is all over. And the superstar breaks the hold. And there you see him, the national heavyweight champion, the superstar, victorious over Fred McKenzie.
Sunday night on...
Try not to talk to the national heavyweight champion, the superstar. It appeared to me that some of the frustrations that you must have felt in your match with Bruce Reed, you took out on this man, McKenzie.
Listen, I'll be the first one to admit that I underestimated Bruce Reed now. I could get out here and run him down and say it wasn't any good, say I beat a man in 5 or 10 minutes, which I didn't do. I think it took me about 12 minutes. But the fact remains is I did beat the man. He's a very, very tough competitor. And to tell you the truth, I don't think I want to get in the ring again in the very near future with Bruce Reed. There's a lot of other individuals around here that I'm itching to get in the ring with. And fellas, this championship belt means that you have to come after me now. I don't have to go searching any longer. I don't have to beg for matches, championship matches, because I'm the champion.
Well, Saturday night, of course, you're looking to gain another championship. I'm referring, of course, to the matches at the Omni Saturday night, August 29th. And, of course, it'll be at 8:30, and it will be Tommy Wildfire Rich, the Georgia title.
Tommy Wildfire Rich. You know, he makes me sick. He comes out here and says, Superstar has got a hard head. But it's not hard because there's any foreign object in my mask. It's hard because I'm a stubborn man. I'm coming after you, Tommy Rich. I had to hunt you down, had to embarrass you, open your head wide open. Only gave you 13 stitches. I wanted to give you more. But some of your friends came down and saved you. Now, for those people who don't realize, I already won a match that night in the Omni, and I have volunteered to go in after that belt. But now it's going to be one match and one match only. This belt's not at stake, Rich, but yours is. I'm coming to the Omni, and Tommy Rich, I'm going to be a stubborn man. I'm going to be a hard opponent, but I'm going to be the next Georgia heavyweight champion.
Australian tag team match now, wrestling two, and Kevin Von Erich moving out against the team of Dave Sierra and Bobby Garrett. And correction, Medina and the Angel. Medina and the Angel. My mistake there. Jose Medina and the Angel moving out against wrestling two and... Kevin Von Erich. Kevin Von Erich in the white trunks in the ring at this time. Keeping Medina's arm tied up now, and now it is Von Erich. Good. Flying head scissors takes Medina to the canvas. Medina, of course, from San Juan, Puerto Rico. Medina trying to bridge out and escape from that head scissors if he can. And notice the way Von Erich brought him right on over and gave him a short pile driver. Medina looking around, wondering what's happened to him. Von Erich, as young as he is, has an amazing repertoire of holds. Good fluid motion, and teamed up with, of course, the legendary wrestling two. What a tag team combination. You can see the effect of those mat burns on Von Erich's elbows, also on his knees. He wears a protective padding on the knees, and necessarily so. But those elbows also have taken a lot of punishment. High waistlift takedown by wrestling two. Wrestling two gets the head scissors, makes the tag now. It's Medina making the tag with the Angel on wrestling two. Knowing full well the Angel's reputation, back on his feet very quickly, watching his man. Wrestling two slips away, and the Angel, back on his feet, suddenly realizes he was close to that corner. A hurried consultation with Jose Medina. Side headlock by the Angel. Tag was made. Kevin Von Erich caught him with a good drop kick coming off the ropes. Kevin Von Erich underhooks the arm into an arm drag takedown. Notice there was some interesting countering going on there as the Angel was trying to move to an advantage position. Kevin Von Erich outmaneuvered him, however. Was able to cinch in deep with that arm. Von Erich looked like he was trying to hook in with the foot to the crotch for a takedown, but blocked by the Angel, and now the Angel, using those forearms very effectively, tags up with Jose Medina. Medina taking an unfair advantage here before that count of four was over. Medina, double clubs to the head, Von Erich. After the Angel, and Medina behind him continues to punish him. And Von Erich might be well advised here to get over and tag up if he could. Beautiful drop kick from a standing position. Snapmare has Medina down, reaches up, makes the tag with Wrestling 2. Medina coming back to his feet, Wrestling 2. Forearm drag and twist on Medina. More pressure again on Medina. Again, Kevin Von Erich being very effective using the elbow, keeping the full arm drag and twist. Talking to two friends of mine during the week, Orlando Garcia and Juan Fernandez, and both of them commented on the fact that Von Erich certainly looks like he has that great championship potential, and of course that's the one thing that every athlete wants to become, is the very best in his given sport. In Kevin's case, obviously he'd be looking for that world heavyweight championship. Wrestling 2. A step over on the arm of Jose Medina takes Medina down to the canvas. So Wrestling 2 keeps the pressure on. Notice how Kevin Von Erich reached over and touched the corner at the same time he made the tag with Wrestling 2. That's the way that he has been raised. He is a stickler for abiding by the rules and regulations of the sport, no matter what sport he's in. There's that move by Kevin Von Erich. A step over on the arm, hook into the crotch with a foot, take and score the takedown. Medina trying to regain his feet, upended again by Von Erich. Medina reaching out, trying to get to those ring ropes. And once again, back to the canvas. Now the tag is made, and it's Wrestling 2 moving back into the ring. Kevin Von Erich, good clean break, allows Medina an opportunity. Get back, and it's Wrestling 2. Hooked him with a right hand. Now brings him up, full body slam. And Medina has a handful of problems now. Another forearm across the back that drives Medina back to the canvas, and again. Partial chancery that time. Whipped him into that far turnbuckle. Moves in against him. Makes the tag with Kevin Von Erich. Snapmares Medina to the canvas. Von Erich very quickly on top of his man. Comes down with that elbow across the chest of Medina. Arm drag takedown again by Von Erich. Von Erich, of course, in an earlier match, broke the nose of Rick Pereira in defeating him in a one-fall, 10-minute event, a single match. Von Erich out there now in an Australian tag team match. Off a beautiful forearm coming off the ropes. Got Medina. And Medina has been carrying the brunt of this battle. Once again, Wrestling 2 moves in, having made the tag with Kevin Von Erich. Again, a full body slam on Medina. Drop on Medina. And you'll note now that Kevin Von Erich and Wrestling 2 have pretty well kept Medina to their half of the ring, if you will. Caught him under the left rib cage, the left side of the rib cage. There's that lateral body scissors into a partial lateral roll. Had the pressure cinched, Medina was sufficiently stunned that he could not put it together. I don't even think he was aware of the fact the count was on. And Medina still on the canvas, still trying to clear his head. He took an awful lot of punishment, was never really able to get over and tag up with the Angel. And so the winners of this match would be the tag team combination of Kevin Von Erich and Wrestling 2. Okay, another friendly reminder right now, of course, that we'll be returning to our regular time of 5:35 Eastern Daylight Time next week. We certainly hope that some of you folks who perhaps have not caught our show in the past and were on at this earlier hour, that you'll keep joining us each and every week, 5:35 Eastern Daylight Time. And right now, then, to bring each and every one of you information about wrestling that may well be within the area in which you live, here's the man with all the news, Freddie. All right, we've got an Australian tag team match coming up. Michael Hayes and Tommy Wildfire Rich. And as we said, of course, this is the first, and that's Michael Hayes into the ring, the original Freebird, and Tommy Wildfire Rich. And as we said, a television first to watch these two as a tag team combination, facing a very, very tough team in Bobby Garrett and David Sierra. May I just point out now that Garrett and Sierra, I understand, have been in a rather intensive training regimen. This is a test for them as to their tag team prowess. Now, Hayes and Wildfire Rich, I doubt, in my own mind, I doubt seriously if they have had much time socializing together or working out together. But nonetheless, we are very curious to see just exactly how they will function as a tag team combination. Tommy Wildfire Rich moves in. Once again, a quick reminder on that most popular wrestler contest. Michael Hayes or Tommy Wildfire Rich, Wrestling 2. Steve-O, the superstar. I don't care. Whoever your favorite is, just drop us a postcard listing your favorite wrestler. And, of course, we'll have that beautiful trophy to award later on. Up and over his man, Sierra leapfrogs over. And Tommy Wildfire Rich caught him with an arm drag takedown. Another arm drag takedown. Garrett moves in, and he's caught with two arm drag takedowns, and both men outside the ring. And so Tommy Rich proving very quickly that he'll take any and all. And there you see a very pleased Michael Hayes. As we're saying, if you care to send in a postcard for your favorite wrestler, please do so. Send it to Georgia Championship Wrestling, 100 Techwood Drive. Techwood Drive, Northwest Atlanta, Georgia, 30303. Full Nelson by Tommy Wildfire Rich, and Hayes lets fly on Sierra and dropped him to the canvas. Wildfire has the side headlock. Sierra. Sierra went for the head scissors. Wildfire broke away from it. Tag is made, and here's Michael Hayes, and this is sort of a rare opportunity. You don't get a chance to see Michael Hayes in action in the squared circle very often, but he's there. And as you can tell, Hayes, who has been an athlete all of his life, obviously been conditioning himself. Garrett has him up against the ring ropes. Garrett squares off. Hayes was ready. And referee Nick Patrick warning both men about those closed fists. Hayes opens up, so does Garrett. Hayes caught him coming in. Hayes's tactics certainly haven't changed any. He may have a slightly different philosophy, but his tactics in the ring certainly have not changed. He is just as vicious and as merciless as he's always been. Hayes down across the chest of Bobby Garrett. Certainly want to wish my friend Mark Cutney of the Buccaneers a speedy recovery. Mark, more than likely out for the entire season, a tough break. Great athlete. Tommy Wildfire Rich back in action against Bobby Garrett. Bill Sear on the outside watching, as is Michael Hayes. Drop to hold by Wildfire, and a good float up. Overhooks the head. And Garrett twisting away from it, trying to reverse on Tommy Rich. Gets the hammerlock. Encouragement being shouted to Tommy Rich from Michael Hayes now. Wildfire slipped away from that Sullivan bar and now back on his feet. Side headlock by Wildfire, Tommy Rich. Garrett brings him over and Sierra ties him up. Garrett, some cheap shots there while Sierra had him tied up. Michael Hayes protesting that situation, being forced back to his corner by the referee, and now Sierra taking full advantage of that situation. Sierra, hard right hand. Another wicked right hand. Good block by Rich. Rear somersault tags up. Michael Hayes moves in. Hayes exploding on Sierra. Hayes, the flat of the foot. Sierra explodes now, tags up. Bobby Garrett moves in. Full body slam on Bobby Garrett. Hayes has him up for the pile driver, and Garrett is gone. That is all she wrote for one Bobby Garrett. And so, as we said earlier, television history made here today. Michael Hayes and Tommy Wildfire Rich, the Georgia heavyweight champion, as tag team partners, victorious in their very, very first ever tag team match here on Georgia Championship Wrestling. And, of course, they are both primarily single wrestlers, if you will. But they have certainly proven that they have that great tag team capability. I was curious to see if the ego factor would have anything to do with their capabilities in the ring. Obviously, it did not. Both men acted as a very, very well-oiled machine and certainly were victorious in an outstanding match against Bobby Garrett and this David Sierra. Well, the superstar, of course, with the National Heavyweight Championship, now after the Georgia Heavyweight Championship, currently held by Tommy Wildfire Rich. But as we have seen and as we have said so many times, any title can change hands just with a twinkling of that 1-2-3 count, that fatal count of three. And I do believe we have a standby match upcoming. And Brian St. John, one of the principal competitors in that. They're now helping Sierra and Garrett outside the ring. Garrett, of course, taking the full brunt. So let's turn to the ring now. Brian St. John in those dark brown trunks. His opponent in the blue trunks. Drop toe hold by St. John. A float up on his man. Into those ropes, and the referee calls for the break. All right, Dave Stanley back on his feet now, and it is Brian St. John circling his man. Gets him in a side headlock. From side headlock to side headlock into a hammerlock. Just a moment remaining here as Brian St. John scoring rather effectively on Stanley. And Stanley, quite possibly somewhat intimidated by Brian St. John. St. John has made the statement that he was going to rub every wrestler's nose into the mat that had ever faced him when he was here in Georgia one time in the past. I don't ever remember him wrestling this man, Stanley, but obviously St. John's reputation. Beautiful move from a bear hug to a power slam, and it is all over. It is all over. Brian St. John scoring so very, very effectively. Caught his man coming off the ropes. Hooked the full body in the bear hug. Brought him around into a total power slam. Brought him down to the canvas. The count of three, and it is all over. Once again, let me show you this beautiful trophy that will be presented to the most popular wrestler. All you have to do is send your postcard nominating your favorite wrestler to Georgia Championship Wrestling, 100 Techwood Drive Northwest, Atlanta, Georgia, 30303. And Freddie and I will be on hand to present that trophy in the near future.
And Gordon, tomorrow, Best Of will be on at its regular time, 5:35. And next week, we'll be back at 5:35, too. See you then.
Absolutely. Till then, so long from the Peach State of Georgia.
Thanks for watching Georgia Championship Wrestling. The announcers on this program are employed by Georgia Championship Wrestling Incorporated. Join us again next week for Georgia Championship Wrestling.